All right, so we'll read the translation of the second shloka of Srimad Bhagavatam. Who would like to read?
I will read, Prabhuji.
Yes, please.
Completely rejecting all the religious activities which are materially motivated, this Bhagavata Purana propounds the highest truth, which is understandable by those devotees who are fully pure in heart. The highest truth is reality distinguished from illusion for the welfare of all. Such truth uproots the threefold miseries. This beautiful Bhagavatam, compiled by the sage Vyasadeva and his maturity is sufficient in itself for God realization. What is the need of any other scripture? As soon as one attentively and submissively hears the message of Bhagavatam, this culture of knowledge, the Supreme Lord is established within his heart.
Hare Krishna, so nicely read. Thank you for reading. So, Srimad Bhagavatam here is propounding the highest truth. And this highest truth, who can understand? Nirmatsara Nama Satam. What is the meaning of Nirmatsara?
Non-envious, Prabhuji.
Yes, non-envious. So, one of the biggest hurdle, obstacle in attaining to our real constitutional position or the love of God is that we may be able to control senses if we are very advanced. We may be able to control the mind if we are even more advanced. We may be able to control the intelligence if we are even more advanced. But actually, the ego is the reason because of which still we may not be able to go back to Godhead. So, because of the ego, this envious mentality is there. So, nirmatsarana means non-envious. That is, means fully pure. A person who is non-envy, yes, is fully pure in heart. So, how do you know the symptoms of somebody who is non-envious and pure? Can anybody share?
Pure heart or loving heart. I don't know. Humble.
Okay, humble. Very nice. Pure, loving. What else?
Prabhuji, they have no tendency of fault finding or criticizing.
Yes. Remember in the Nectar of Instruction, we read this Uttam Adhikari, one of the qualities of Uttam Adhikari, that they have no tendency of criticizing others. So that is a sign of one who is non-envious.
Envy. I have a comment here.
Yes, ma'am.
Can I say that?
Yes, ma'am.
And it could be also a question. So, yeah, that's a very pure stage, like not able to criticize anybody. But then we know that, especially if you are in academia, we are always told, and even in the practical life, we are always told, be critical. Critical in the sense how you exercise your brain. When even for students or, you know, that you have to be critical. So So where do you draw the line? It's very hard. I don't know. So what is spirituality has to or has advice for human beings in general or for people in general, what you should be doing to not be critical in a way that means more meaningful or that is more meaningful to advance in spiritual life? You know, I don't know if that made sense.
So that is a very nice question. Thank you, Mataji. So I'll repeat the question. The question is that here it says completely pure in heart, having no tendency of fault finding. But then we have been trained to, you know, be critique certain, items or projects that may be a part of our service. So how to deal with that? Do we not identify what is wrong? What is wrong in identifying what is wrong? Right? What is wrong in identifying what is wrong?
Right, exactly. what is wrong in identifying? I like that. Yes, absolutely. It's very hard. It's a dilemma, I don't know.
So the answer to the question is this. Actually, when we are correcting someone or doing welfare to someone, it does not mean not finding faults necessarily ever. For example, a parent may see the child has not drawn D properly. So instead of writing D, they put a mirror image of D. Like sometimes children do that. Now you are not going to say, oh, wow, this is how D is written. This is the best. This boy, he knows. So you're not going to say that, right? You're not going to say, I'm going to change all the D's and make this as a D. No, you're going to correct him or her. And you're going to say, but how you correct that depends. And actually, that is not considered as fault finding. That is considered as a part of training. You're training the child. And the difference is that when you have envy, then that is fault finding. You have to have no envy, which means that when you are correcting somebody, it should hurt you more than that person who's actually getting corrected. That feeling should be there. And it should come with an intention of giving benefit to the other person. Sometimes we may not realize whether in the garden there is actually a plant or a weed. If you don't have a training, you may consider a weed to be the plant. Like a child, you may say, oh, go put water in the garden. So the child may go put water in the garden and he may start watering the weeds. He may not know what are weeds and what are not. Similarly, sometimes we don't realize that actually because of our envy, we are finding fault in somebody else. People get into this tendency of gossiping and talking about other people and passing comments about other people. Many a times it comes because of the tendency of envy. That is very prevalent in the society. So teaching, correcting, training, that does not arise from a feeling of envy. But actually that should arise with a feeling of doing good to the other person, right? Non-envious means there is no competition. There is no feeling that the other person is wrong, no. The feeling is that how I can make him even better than where it is. So we are already seeing so many good qualities in the other person. And now we are saying, oh, if we do this, then it will be even better, right? So that is how we have to approach the situation. Is it making sense, Mataji?
Yes, Yes, Prabhuji, absolutely. Thank you.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. So this is how the guru is supposed to train the disciple. The guru identifies small things in the disciple and sees, oh, this is how a particular thing could be his strength. Similarly, how parents should identify what is the nature of the child, and they have to flare the spark. Like if the child is really wanting to do something, right? Really wanting to do something. And the parents are saying, no, no, no. And then it is up to the parents whether they want to call this, oh, my child is so stubborn. Or they want to see it, oh, my child is so determined. He really wants to do something, right? So it is the same quality actually of bending upon what they want to do. But at the same time, how parents are seeing it will determine whether you are actually going to be a coach, a mentor, a guide for the child, or are you going to have clashes with the child where you won't be able to understand, groom, and mentor the child. And even if you know these things theoretically, still it's very hard. But still, at least you now have an understanding and the training. And that's what Srimad Bhagavatam and the devotees gave us, the training. Actually, this is a literature which is meant for those who are pure at heart because they can understand it completely. So therefore, we should hear from such people. So therefore, regularly we listen lectures, we attend classes, we go to the temples, of course, when COVID is not there. And even right now, with Zoom, we have so much availability, and YouTube, we have so much availability of either getting distracted into other things or taking association with devotees. So many of you here, you are so inspiring. Rakshita Mataji, Natasha Mataji, and so many other devotees who keep sharing lectures on the group, Nirbhay Prabhu. And they are watching, hearing, listening, and sharing with us. So this is how we can use these tools to not make us fool, but actually to make us understand the deep knowledge of Srimad Bhagavatam. Because Srimad Bhagavatam has so much depth, to the extent we are receptive, eager, longing, wanting, to that extent, Srimad Bhagavatam will reveal it to us. Some people are just so much immersed in Srimad Bhagavatam. They love reading. And you can see. And of course, I can say for myself, I have no taste for Srimad Bhagavatam because a lot of taste is there for material things and not so much, realization. But as we keep hearing, I can see how I was maybe, 20 years ago, and I can see how I am right now. That even though I have no taste, but still I'm much better than what I was in terms of knowing Bhagavad Gita or even wanting to know Bhagavad Gita or Srimad Bhagavatam. So like that, things will maybe slow, but at the same time, eventually it will keep improving. Does it make sense, Mataji?
Absolutely. Thank you, Prabhuji. Very nice example.
Okay, thank you. Anybody else wants to add something to what Mataji questioned? Mataji's question was?
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Yes, Mataji, go ahead.
So while you were sharing, this is what occurred to me. So in short, what matters is the intention behind criticizing. So if it's a teacher or parent, criticizing, their intention, they're not envious. Their intention is to teach, to make the other person improve and grow. Whereas we are just gossiping and fault finding whimsically, then that's enviousness.
Yes, very nice. Yes, Mataji. Perfect. That is very nicely summarized. However, I would like to add, teacher means or parent means someone who is in that role either by default or because the disciple approached the teacher. We should not consider ourselves as a self-appointed teacher or watchdog to, no, I'm doing it for their betterment. I'm doing for other person. And we start giving, you know, our advice to others by saying that, oh, you know, actually he's doing right, nice, but I want him to improve more. So I'm giving my 2 cents. And with that 2 cents, I gave a huge, you know, 2 hour or 2 page long, you know, write about that person, that how this person is good for nothing. Of course, I'm exaggerating a little, but that is how mind's tendency is. We should see what responsibility Krishna has given us and try to focus on doing that more. Like in Bhagavad Gita also Krishna says, right? Better to do your work, even though imperfectly, than to do other person's work, even if you think it's perfectly. So similarly, the intention is very important, and sticking to what our duty, our role, our situation is. If somebody is really wanting to, like, for example, I'll tell you one thing, a very nice example. The first time I gave a lecture in front of bigger audience, like it was a temple, informal setting, not like a formal Vyasasana or anything. It was just an informal setting, and I was asked, in fact, ordered by one of the senior devotees to give a lecture. And I said, no, I have never given, I can't give. He said, no, I saw you speaking, you should speak. So I said, no, I cannot. He said, no, you must. So I said, Prabhuji, if you order me, I can, you know, say something, but he said, yes, go. And then he said, maybe you can say this, say, but you have to say. I said, okay, Prabhu, I'll speak on this shloka. He said, okay. So I went there, I spoke, gave the lecture, and then I came back. And then I asked Prabhuji, please tell me what mistakes I did and how I can improve. So he said, no, wonderful class, amazing. And I said, no, Prabhu, please tell me. So I literally had to persistently say to him multiple times, Prabhu, please tell me. And finally, after a long time, actually, he told me, and he told me so many things actually, which were not right in the sense how I could have improved, how that lecture could have been better. I was just going through the story very fast. I just didn't even go to the details or anything. And there were new people. And Prabhu told me, why you didn't tell the story? I thought that's why you've taken the shloka. And, you know, so like that, he told me, but see, so long, he didn't tell me, and he only glorified my lecture. Even though, you know, it was just an ordinary thing. I had not even prepared. It was like 5 minutes. And he said, it's wonderful. And he was just glorifying. So this gives you a sense of how the mentality is of an advanced Vaishnava. Does it make sense?
Yes, Prabhuji.
Because that person could have first time only told, right? First time only, because I am anyways much junior to him. He asked me to give a class. Now he could have said that, okay, these are the things which you should improve. That would have been okay. But because he was only focused on seeing the positive, he didn't even see the negative till he was actually requested multiple times, and then he had to put his mind and energy in trying to focus that how I can help this person elevate and advance. So this is how Srimad Bhagavatam trains us. This is how advanced Vaishnavas association helps us in giving up that mentality of criticizing. But sometimes we have to train. It is very important to be strict. Parents cannot just say to the child, okay, everything. No. In fact, the learned people say 5 years to 10 years is the age where the training is extremely important to the child. If needed, whatever needs to be done. But of course, parents should be trained how to train the child. If we are not trained and we lose our connection with the child, then once the child is in a teenage, he or she will not be connected to the parents. He or she will have his own separate life. And that's how most people, most children, most family is. They don't have the connection. we call it generation gap or so many other things, but they cannot. Why? Because parents don't consider them friend in teenage years. They still feel that he or she should do what I want them to do. And that becomes problematic. But we see that there was training at every stage in the Vedic culture, but at the same time, once they are independent, they can make decisions. Many times, even in the Vedic culture, many people made a lot of wrong decisions. And parents, even though tried, could not necessarily change, but they had the opportunity to train the child. And even before the child is born, you know, having the proper samskaras, garbhodhan samskara and everything, all these things help. But not to distract from the point, the intention is extremely important, and one has to take up the service. Like for example, Srimad Bhagavatam says, right, Guru na sasyat, Swajano na sasyat, Pita na sasyat, Janani na sasyat, right? that one should not accept these positions. So if somebody has accepted these position of being a father, mother, husband, demigod, guru, then he or she will have to focus on delivering the dependence from the cycle of birth and death. So it now it's their service to do it. Till the time that particular position is not there, we don't have the service. So we should better focus on what is our service. But once that position is accepted, then it is our service to help our dependents to come out of it. Does it give some insight?
Yes, Prabhuji. Very well. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Natasha Mataji, is that okay? Anything you want to add?
Yes, Prabhuji. Thank you.
Okay, great. So here, this particular line is very beautiful and very, very interesting, worth memorizing actually. And I know Nirbhay Prabhu yesterday was beautifully mentioning about it. The highest truth is reality distinguished from illusion for the welfare of all. Now in science, many times we study about what is happening in nature, right? We may have certain experiments by which we come, bring, you know, material elements together and study and learn the facts. But science can help us, let's say, in creating an atom bomb, right? But science cannot actually help us in making a decision whether to use that atom bomb or not. That is something which only spiritual training can help him. How much he or she is trained to think about the welfare of all. The welfare of all is extremely important when we are talking about character's value and spiritual upliftment. So Srimad Bhagavatam actually helps us in thinking about the welfare of all, and how does it actually gives us the fact also. Just what science does. Science helps us in coming to the truth or figuring out what is actually the fact and the reality. And Srimad Bhagavatam does that, but Srimad Bhagavatam goes beyond and it tells the reality at the highest level, at the highest truth, Srimad Bhagavatam is telling, and it is distinguishing it from illusion. Because there are four defects of human beings, right? What are the four defects? Anybody can tell? Yes, imperfect senses. Yes.
Tendency to error. Make mistakes.
Yes, make mistakes.
Illusion and cheating.
Illusion and cheating, yes. So illusion. So we have a tendency of getting illusioned. So Srimad Bhagavatam helps us in coming out of the illusion and seeing the reality distinct from illusion. And to apply it for the welfare of all. That is the beauty of Srimad Bhagavatam. That is how it gives us the spiritual intelligence. This is the way we can practically apply for everyone. Does this make sense?
Yes, Prabhuji.
Okay. Now the other thing is, here it mentions in the first line is dharma projita kaitavatra paramo. Kaitava dharma. So kaitava dharma, kaitav means basically covered or cheating propensity, cheating religion, right? It rejects from the very beginning only, Srimad Bhagavatam rejects cheating religion. Now let's say if a person gives you an item which was much less value than how much you paid, then you will feel, oh, I got cheated. Am I right? The person gave you something which is much less value than how much you paid. So then you will feel, oh, I was cheated. Am I right?
Yes, Prabhuji.
So similarly, people come take shelter of religion, sometimes shelter of God, and think this is the highest thing. But actually, what they get, they just get some material proposals that, oh, you know, if you do this, you will get some, you know, money, dhanam, janam, sundarim, you know, those things. Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, na dhanam, na janam, na sundarim. But generally, kaitav dharma, cheating religion is there. So fruitive mentality is there. So Srimad Bhagavatam actually is rejecting all this. And it is giving the highest truth to us. So if we dedicate our life just with the cheating religion mentality, then we miss out because only one human life we got. And now that also we just wasted. So it is like getting a Mercedes car and using it in the fields to plow the field. Or taking in a road, which is actually not meant for it. So then the person who gave you the Mercedes car, he'll be like, oh, this person, he doesn't know how to use proper things. So we won't give him, right? So similarly, human body is given to us and now we misuse it. We don't use it for the proper reason. Then it will, you know, it is not something we'll get it again. So right now we have it. Let's use it properly by reading the Srimad Bhagavatam. So we'll read this translation once again with this mindset. Mama, you want to read? My mother will read it. Okay. She wants to. And then we will see if anybody else wants to share anything, and otherwise we'll start reading.
Completely rejecting all religious activities which are materially motivated, this Bhagavat Puran propounds the highest truth, which is understandable by those devotees who are fully pure in heart. The highest truth is reality, distinguished from illusion, for the welfare of all. Such truth uproots the threefold miseries. This beautiful Bhagavatam, compiled by the great sage Vyasadeva in his maturity, is sufficient in itself for God really. What is the need of any other scripture? As for ultimate or ultimate alternatively and submissively, here's the message of Bhagavatam. By this culture of knowledge, the Supreme Lord is established within his heart.
Hare Krishna, thank you. See, the other thing, when I first read this chapter, I was thinking, who is speaking this shloka? Because here it is saying, this beautiful Bhagavatam compiled by great sage Vyasadeva in his maturity is sufficient in itself for God realization. Did any of you get that question? Or no?
Yes,
I cannot hear anybody.
Prabhuji, I mean, I took it, I understood it as a statement, but not as a question. Like, they're trying to say that because he was mature enough to, when he was writing this.
No, so, my question is, who is saying?
Sutta Goswami.
Okay, Sutta Goswami, okay. Anybody else? So, Rakshitamaji is Sutta Goswami saying. Who else would like to say?
Vasudeva, no?
Who?
Vyasadeva himself.
Vyasadeva himself, okay. Anybody else?
Parikshit Maharaj.
Okay, Parikshit Maharaj. Okay, anybody else?
Prabhuji, these translations are also done by Srila Prabhupada only, na?
Or, this translation is also done by Prabhupada, so Prabhupada. Maybe Prabhupada is saying?
Prabhuji, I go with two, Sudh Goswami and Prabhupada both.
Okay, so both are saying?
Yes,
or one of them? Or one of them?
So actually, Prabhuji, Sudh Goswami said, and Prabhupada is agreeing with that.
Okay, all right. Anybody else? Yes, Bharati Mataji sharing. Yes, ma'am.
Prabhuji.
Sorry, Mataji, you are mute. You
didn't do it. No,
actually, I was doing the rest of it. You are mute.
Okay. So, Prabhuji, this is said by Vyasadeva, the three shlokas, as was told in kids' class in the Kahoot. So, but if you read the shloka, there is no mention of Vyasadeva in the whole shloka itself, if you read the Sanskrit only. So when we see the translation, the word by word translation, so Vyasadeva is put in as the great sage. So that is Prabhupada's input.
Okay. But here it says Mahamuni, great sage.
Yes.
So he is telling himself.
Narad Muni great sage.
Yes, that is now, that is, he is referring to Narad Muni, I think.
Who? Who is referring?
Vyasadeva.
But this is compiled, this is not compiled by Narad Muni, right?
Narad Muni only inspired him to write Srimad Bhagavatam.
Okay. Okay, let's see. I think Suresh Prabhu is sharing something. Suresh Prabhu? I cannot hear.
Narad Muni is the spiritual master of Vyasadeva. Okay. That's what he's giving the its direction to him, that he's giving, he has written with his full maturity, I mean full knowledge, deep understanding.
Okay. So if it's Narad Muni, then why Prabhupada is writing Vyasadeva then? In parentheses.
No, the question was that who is saying that in his maturity? Means this is the Narad Muni is saying that Vyasadeva has written this with full deep understanding.
Oh, so you are saying, So Bharati Mataji said this shloka is said by Vyasadeva, but Suresh Prabhu is saying this shloka is said by Narad Muni. Okay, now I get it.
No, Prabhuji, my question.
Oh, okay.
Aapka question ye tha ki ye jo hai na maturity mein kis kaun bola hai, who said that?
No. My question is, who is speaking this shloka? This shloka, who is speaking? Who is speaking that this Bhagavatam is compiled by Vyasadeva? Okay, yes. Shirisha Mataji.
What was the question?
Shirisha Mataji. What is the question?
Vyasadeva.
Okay, good question. What is the question? Okay, anybody else? Yes, so Rohan is also saying Vyasadeva, Bharati Mataji is saying Vyasadeva, and Rakshita Mataji said some...
I also said Vyasadeva before.
Okay. I said Sutta Goswami and Prabhupada. I said two, yes. Sutta Goswami first.
Rakshita Mataji is fixed. Okay, all right. Anybody else? And nobody Narad Muni? Oh, Suresh Prabhu is saying Narad Muni, yes. Okay. Anyone else?
I think Narad Muni Prabhuji.
Okay, Shri Shyamataji also Narad Muni. Okay. Anybody else? I didn't hear Nirbhay Prabhu or Raja Mataji saying anything. I think they want to answer in the end.
Prabhuji, I think Vyasdev only. I just don't know why he is referring to himself as Mahamuni. I don't know that. So I have no input.
All right. Ankita Mataji?
Prabhuji, I am also thinking it's Vyasdev because he wrote this Bhagavata, but why he mentioned like himself as creator, I don't know.
See, that was my doubt when I read this first time. That, you know, I can't understand who is even speaking the first couple of shlokas, you know. And actually, the answer is, most of you rightly said, it is Srila Vyasadeva. Srila Vyasadeva is the one who's compiling this, Srimad Bhagavatam. And basically, just like now, you know, we say, oh, I'm Dr. Kapoor, or, you know, somebody said, I'm Dr. Parashar, right? So similarly, Ved Vyas is Mahamuni, right? So he's just saying, Mahamuni has written. So there is no ego here, right? We think, oh, it is a big thing he's thinking or saying. But like Bharati Mataji nicely explained, that Mahamuni Krite Kim, right? So he's just saying that is written by Mahamuni means it's not greatness of me. It is the greatness of Srimad Bhagavatam that it is being compiled by Mahamuni, not some ordinary here person who's unauthorized, not like that. So he's giving his qualification that, okay, this is Dr. Kapoor who is giving you this medicine so that you take it. Is it making sense to everybody?
Yes, Prabhuji. This is like, I think this, it used to be a style of writing. Like if when we read Kabir Doha, Kahulu Kabira, or Surdas Bhajan or Meera's Bhajan, is this something like that? Similar
yeah,
to that?
Yeah, but the point here is that he's saying Mahamuni because of this, like he's, you know.
Self-designating himself.
No, he's not. He's actually conveying that this Srimad Bhagavatam is not an ordinary book which is written by anybody. It is written by someone who's authorized, who is learned. And I have, as he's going to explain how he has learned. And therefore, this is appropriately given. And one should understand that this is actually not like a cheating thing. This is to be understood by those who are pure. Why? Because of this. Is it making sense?
Yes.
He's glorifying the Srimad Bhagavatam, not himself. But at the same time, giving you the confidence that it is coming to you from the right source. Okay? Is it okay? Just like I was giving an example of the medicine. That, okay, this medicine will really help you. And then, you know, who are you to tell, well, I have got a training. I have, you know, my license. This is, I'm doctor. So similarly, he's conveying this. Yes. Is it making sense?
Yes, Prabhuji.
Okay. So this is Vyas. Yes, Prabhuji. Oh, sure. Okay. So anything else anybody wants to share from the translation? So this is extremely important also. What happens then? Okay, this is there, understood by Nirmatsara. Then what happened? You attentively hear, attentively and submissively hear this message. What will happen if I hear? Well, the culture of the knowledge of the Supreme Lord will be established in your heart. Right now, our heart is doing lot of other things, right? Distracted, not controlled mind, and having so much impurities, addicted to all sorts of other things. But once the Lord actually is established in our heart. Now, Paramatma obviously is always in our heart, but we are not listening to the Paramatma. Lord established in the heart means heart has become so pure that, you know, the Jiva bird is looking at the Paramatma bird and actually establishing the connection. And that is what it means, that the Lord is actually, now we have the actual realization that how we have to act in this life, and we are acting in that way. That means the Lord has established that. We are sharing the Lord with others. We are sharing and engaging in those activities which are spiritual and Krishna conscious. That is the symptom. Is it making sense?
Yes, Prabhuji.
Okay, great. Anybody else would like to add anything? Okay, so Prabhupada starts the purport by talking about religion, right? Religion, Prabhupada is mentioning here, because you all already read the purport before. I'm just, you know, giving a little explanation because of the time constraints. Then, of course, we can do the reading and other people can comment. But Prabhupada is mentioning about the religion in general. So, dharmam, artha, kama, moksha, right? The purusharthas, the four purusharthas. These people are following these primary subjects as a religion, right? And actually, Srimad Bhagavatam doesn't really let you do whatever you are doing. Srimad Bhagavatam actually brings you to the, uplifts you to the Pancham Purusharta, highest Purusharta. So what we are doing is, the religion in itself is dharma, artha, kama, moksha. So we are into this material bondage. And let's say if we don't do this religion, because this religion is binding, let's say somebody is irreligious. So what? So that is even worse. That is barbarous, Prabhupada is writing. Right? That is even more detrimental. So somebody is doing religion, okay, he is doing some karmas, but he's going to get bound. But if somebody is not doing religion, that is even worse. Right? So even though we may be doing religion or irreligion, when we got this human birth, then we cannot stay at the stage of just eating, sleeping, waiting, and defending. Right? That is animalistic life. So animals are doing, we are doing. If we do what animals are doing, then the scripture says you are dvipad pashu, dvi, two-legged animals. You may be very sophisticated. You may be doing it in a nice, comfortable place. But if you, this is what you are doing, eating, sleeping, mating, defending. So defending means huge. We defend our ego. We defend our house, our property, our family, our living entities, our ego. Everything we are defending, actually. And we are making things more comfortable so that we can eat nicely, sleep nicely, you know, mate nicely. All these things we are doing. So, what is going to make us from dvipad pashu to actual human being? That is the presence of the spiritual connection. That is what is the human life is meant for. That is what is our actual, real business when we have got this human body. And that is to attend to the spiritual function. So common language, it is the religion. Religion is the thing which animals cannot do. You cannot have too many animals come together. Okay, today we'll do kirtan. Never see that, right? Although Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, you know, made them, but they were not coming by themselves and having that. And that was an exceptional situation. But humans, their life is actually meant for this because they have the intelligence. They have the spiritual intelligence. If one is engaged in that spiritual aspect, then they can say that the human life has actually begun. What does the Vedanta Sutra say about this? Can anybody say? Can anybody tell? When is the human life begun? I think it's the second sutra, if I remember correctly. I could be wrong. Athato Brahma Jigyasa. When Athato Brahma Jigyasa means curiosity, Jigyasa, to know the absolute truth, the Brahman, that is when our human life actually has started. Till that time, that question has not come. Human life is not started. We are still two-legged animal. When that has come and we are taking active steps for it and actually coming out of this rat race of this society, whatever the society has told us, you know, you do this, you do that, and we become slaves of other people's tongue. Like somebody is going to tell us, oh, what you are, you know, you have become totally gone case. You are reading Bhagavad Gita. So then we'll be like, oh no, maybe I should also drink, you know, go in the parties, you know, go to vacations and stuff just because other people. No, not like that. One has to understand what is our relationship with the Lord and spiritual aspect and try to understand that, practice that, whatever other people may think or not think. Of course, impression, perception, they are all important and we have to be mindful for that, but we cannot compromise on our principles. We have to present what we are doing to the other people in a nice way, not change ourselves in order to suit the masses or suit the society. Is that all right?
Yes, Prabhuji.
Yes, Prabhuji.
Okay. So, in the first paragraph here, Prabhupada, this is Prabhupada is what saying. He's saying in human society, there is some form of religion which aims at self-realization and which make reference to man's eternal relationship with God. So that religion, some or the other religion should be there. And in subsequent paragraphs, he's mentioning a little bit more about it, that, you know, lower stages have different and more structured. It's already 9, so I will not go any forward. I just wanted to share a few thoughts about the translation and the purport, because I didn't get to spend much time yesterday. Is that okay? I hope devotees are not feeling it's repetitive or waste of time.
No, Prabhuji. Thank you for explaining.
Yeah.
Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Okay. So anybody else would like to add any points before we conclude? Any question, comments, points, realizations, reflections?
Prabhuji, alag question hai.
Yes, Prabhuji.
Because Krishna knows everything, so then he given the full knowledge to the Arjuna. This is your prescribed duty, you must do it. And this Srimad Bhagavatam was written before to the Mahabharata. Right? Then, I might be wrong.
No, why you are saying it's written before Mahabharata?
Baad mein likha gaya hai?
Huh? We read, na? That all the other scriptures Vyasadeva wrote and he was not satisfied. So then he wrote the Srimad Bhagavatam. And then already the Mahabharata was already done because this is Parikshit Maharaj. He is passing. So all the activities of the Mahabharata are over.
So then inke jo bete the, I mean two sons, right? Pandav and Kauru the inke, Vyasadeva ke the. So inhone apne bete ko sahi se bolte na ki guardianship kyun nahi kiya?
Vyasadeva is not the father. Dhritarashtra is the father of Kauravas. And Pandu is the father of Pandavas. Devrena Sutotpatti. Devrena Sutotpatti principle was applied. In that principle, it is... Sorry. You're talking about Pandu and Dhritarashtra being the sons.
Yeah.
Not the Kauravas and Pandavas.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. So Pandu and Dhritarashtra, they were actually the sons of Vichitravir. When Devrena Sutotpatti principle was applied, the sons are not of the person who engages in the act. The son belongs to the king or the father.
No, to provide, here is the question, like he was the...
Give me a few seconds. I'll be done. So the parent is the is Vichitravir and who was the wife? Ambalika.
Okay.
So under their care they were, and then Vyasadev never was there to train them, bring them, uplift them. No, he just came for a service. He which was given to him. He you know did the service and left. It wasn't his. He was not king. He was not you know doing. He was just asked ordered to do a service. So it wasn't there. So they were supposed to get trained in Hastinapur, and that's how the training happened. And the other generation, they came later, and how Dhritarashtra was attached, and because of his attachment, he made wrong choices and led to death, destruction.
Okay. No, to Prabhuji, that's clear, but the Santanu ki shaadi hui thi Satyavati se, right?
Mm-hmm.
So then he Vyasadeva was related to somehow with Satyavati, right?
Correct. His son. Her son.
Oh, okay. So Rishi Parashar Muni ke aur inke Satyavati ke son the. So somehow it's he related to the Kaurav dynasty only, right? So do unke to inke bete hi.
No, he is Parashar Muni's son. So in that situation, that was an extra like a special circumstance because of which that pastime happened. It doesn't like it is not a norm where Parashar Muni had to bring a very, very exalted personality to this world. And, you know, that Leela pastime happened. So that has no connection with the Vyasadev taking role in the king. Vyasadev is a saint sage. He immediately grew up. There is no Bal Leela of Vyasadev. He immediately appeared, he grew up, he told his mother, whenever you will remember, I'll come back. And then he went to the, you know, like Badrikashram or in the top. So these are, you know, extraordinary situations. These are not. Doesn't mean anything. Krishna is related to Kamsa. Doesn't mean that relation necessarily means that, you know, Kamsa has to be divine. You know, this is how Leelas are arranged. Relation doesn't necessarily mean that the other person will be saintly. Hiranyakashyap had a son, Prahlad, both diametrically opposite. So relation basically doesn't necessarily mean much. It can be helpful, but it may not necessarily be the only reason.
Correct, yes.
Okay, great. So are you satisfied, Prabhuji, with your
question? Yes.
No problem. Anybody else has any questions, comments, any points? Otherwise, we conclude for today. Anything anybody wants to add? I didn't hear from anybody today much. I'm missing devotee speaking. Sorry, I took.
Prabhuji, I just wanted to add something in the Suresh Prabhu's question. So before war begins, Vyasadev came and counseled both time in the task, but he didn't listen that time. And he wanted to give him justice so that you can see kitna nuksan hone wala hai, but somehow he didn't listen, and then he gave the justice to Sandhya.
Yes, thank you, Madhuri. That's a good point. However, Vyasadev did not present himself or said it in a role of a father. He came as a great saint and sage, just like saints and sages have a duty to guide the Kshatriyas. He came in that way and guided them many, many times, actually. And that is how the relationship was. So it was known to them, but still they were, you know, respectful to them as a great sage. And that's how they were respecting and relating. That's my understanding. Does it make sense?
Hare Krishna.
Yes, Madhu.
Here, I too have a doubt. Like,
Vyasadev came as a service for propagating the Kaurav dynasty, Kuru dynasty, and then Dhritarashtra and Pandu were conceived. So basically Vyasadev is the father, because Vidur was also conceived because of Vyasadev, and they consider all of them as brothers. We all consider that Vidur was also a brother of Dhritarashtra and Pandu, although he was born from a maidservant. The father so, were all Pandu, the same.
What is your question? I didn't understand the question. I agree with what you're saying. I agree with what you're saying, but what is the question?
Like, since the father is the same, so they consider Dhritarashtra and Kuru as Dhritarashtra and Pandu and Vidur as brothers. Though mothers may be different.
Yeah.
So the
yeah.
question so, is, so, the question is
right.
that relation does matter, isn't it?
No. The Suresh Prabhu's question was why he was not upbringing the children in a nice way. So the point was that the principle of Devarena Sutotpatti was applied there as per the Vedic, you know, tradition, which is not...
yes, he was
Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu recommended that...
Parents, yes.
Yeah, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu recommended that Devarena Sutotpatti is a principle which is not applied in Kali Yuga. So in previous Yuga, it was used only in very rare circumstances when, you know, there is no ruler and situation. So in that situation, it happens. And the child is actually, this when this happens is when there is no ruler. So the child has to be the ruler. So he wasn't... the father. He was not the father figure or the role there. His service was there. He came, but actually the lineage, they are considered as Bharat Vansh only. It's not that they are from some other lineage. Does it make sense?
Yes, thank you.
Thank you. Great. So that's why Vedvyas did not himself engage in upbringing of the children and everything at every minute. He came as rishis were supposed to, expected to, and he had that connection, like everybody rightly mentioned, to guide the sons in the right path. So he took that role, and that's why he was visible in the Mahabharata many times, actually more visible than Narad Muni. So because of the relationship and stuff, but at the same time, the role was still that of a great sage. Actually, Chaitanya Charan Prabhu explains this nicely in his talk. So I don't remember which lecture it is, but if you watch the lectures of the Mahabharata series he has, you will find, and he has mentioned other places also. So he clarifies this. Okay.
Thank you
very much. Thank you.
I have a question, Prabhuji. So, the Bhagavatam that is online, I was going through that, it has some text. So, I didn't see those slokas. So, is this there online or no?
Yes. So, when you see the text in the Vedabase, click on the number. If you click on 1.1.1, it will open. The slokas will open up.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
आप स्क्रीन शेयर कर रहे हो आप दिखा दो बैक में जाओ और दिखा दो.
I can share. Thank you very much. So ये देखो माशु माता जी, जैसे we went to this section, so we click on the chapter one. Now this chapter one has all the text. Now you click on text one, and it will open up the whole thing. Is it
okay.
Visible?
Yes. Yes. Prabhuji. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.